Hello everybody, welcome back. So we are doing George Bernard Shaw's Spoken English and Broken English. And today we are going to do record number 4, which is the last recording. So let us start. Okay. I am now going to address myself especially to my foreign hearers. I have to give them another warning of quite a different kind. So here, George Bernard Shaw is addressing to the foreign listeners, foreign hearers only, and he is giving them in this recording a special attention. Then he says that he is going to give them a warning today, and a warning which is of a different kind, which nobody else will give them. Okay. If you are learning English because you intend to travel in England and wish to be understood there, do not speak perfect English perfectly. So what is the warning? That this warning is to the foreign hearers, those who want to speak English or to learn English or to travel to England. So this is a warning for them. And what is the warning? That do not try to speak English perfectly. Why? Because if you do, no one will understand you. He says that if the foreign speaker will try to speak English perfectly, then the natives of England will not be able to understand that person. I have already explained that though there is no such thing as perfectly correct English, there is presentable English, which we call good English. So here he says that there is, as he has already told us, that there is no perfectly correct English that exists. So what exists? It is a good English, a good presentable English. Okay, it means the members of the committee which were there to give the correct pronunciation of the word, how they pronounce the word in a presentably good English. Okay, but in London, 999 out of every 1,000 people not only speak bad English, but speak even that very badly. So what is the case of England in speaking English, or especially London, people of London? So they speak English in a very bad way. Okay, you may say that even if they do not speak English well themselves, they can at least understand it well when it is well spoken. So in the second line, he gives a possibility to the hearers that the hearers might be thinking it's okay if the natives of London or England cannot speak English in a very good manner. Then it may happen, probably they would be able to at least understand the well-spoken English. It is a possibility. So now George Bernard Shaw say, they can when the speaker is English, but when the speaker is a foreigner, the better he speaks, the harder it is to understand him. So George Bernard Shaw first of all creates a possibility that the listeners of his recording must be thinking that okay, if the natives cannot speak English well, they can at least understand it well. So here he answers this and says, yes, they can understand a perfectly well-spoken English, but if that is spoken by a co-native person, okay, an English man or English woman only, but if the English is spoken in a perfectly good manner by a foreigner, the natives of English will not be able to understand it. Is that clear? No foreigner can stress the syllables and make the voice rise and fall in question and answer, assertion and denial, in refusal and consent, in inquiry or information exactly as a native does. So why the natives of England are not able to understand a well-spoken English by a foreigner? Why? Because it is okay, he says that a foreigner can speak English in a very good manner, but a foreigner with all of his efforts cannot imitate or copy the way the natives of England speak. He cannot stress the syllables in the same way as the natives stress. Okay, he cannot rise the or fall the voice while asking the question and answering that question, while giving some assertion, saying yes or denying something. Or he cannot imitate the native speakers the way the natives refuse or give their consent or inquire regarding some information. So ultimately, what George Bernard wants to say is that even after doing so many efforts in learning English and speaking English perfectly, a foreigner cannot exactly copy the way a native speaks English. Therefore, the first thing you have to do is to speak a strong foreign accent and speak broken English. So then what a foreigner should do in such a case? If such is the case, what is the solution for the foreigner? The solution is that the foreigner should not leave his accent. He should not try to copy the natives of England. He should remain or he should retain his foreign accent only. And second thing is, he should speak broken English. So now we have in front of us, the title of this essay is Justified: Spoken English and Broken English. Okay, this line is important. Therefore, the first thing you have to do is to speak with a strong foreign accent. And second thing is, speak broken English. Broken English means grammar, English without any grammar. So what is the meaning of broken English in the title? That English, speaking English without following any grammatical rules. Then every English person to whom you speak will at once know that you are a foreigner and try to understand you and be ready to help you. So here George Bernard Shaw says, if the foreigner who wants to speak English and that person travels to England and there he talks to the natives of England and there he follows his foreign accent, speaks broken English, then what will happen? The English persons will immediately recognize that you are a foreigner and they will be ready to help you. He will not expect you to be polite and use elaborate grammatical phrases. He will be interested in you because you are a foreigner and pleased by his cleverness in making out your meaning and being able to tell you what you want to know. So here he says that after recognizing that you are a foreigner, the English person will immediately help you. Okay, and now what are the expectations of an English person from a foreigner? An English person or an English native doesn't expect a foreigner to be polite to him or to use elaboratively grammatical phrases. Means, if you speak your foreign accent and don't use the grammar in your sentences, it's all right. If you want to travel to England, you can. And why the native will help a foreigner? Because he will be interested in the foreigner, and he will be interested in the way the foreigner will be speaking, and he will try to make out the meaning of what the foreigner is speaking, and then will try to help the foreigner. If you say, now he has these lines from this to this have been clarified with the help of an example. If you say, if a foreigner will ask from a native like this, will you have the goodness, sir, to direct me to the railway terminus at Charing Cross? Pronouncing all the vowels and consonants beautifully, he will not understand you and suspect you of being a beggar or a confidence trickster. So here in these lines, what George Bernard Shaw says, first of all, if you are a foreigner, don't be polite with the natives. Second thing, don't use grammatical phrases, okay? And this sentence is full of politeness and uses grammatical phrases, okay? So if you will say these words and if you are so polite to a native, then he will or she will consider you as a beggar or a trickster. Trickster means either a thief or a kind of thief. Okay? So if you give them so much of respect, they will think of you as if you are a beggar. Now, if you are not polite with the native and you don't use grammatical phrases, then what will happen? And if you shout, please Charing Cross, which way? You will have no difficulty. Half a dozen people will immediately overwhelm you with directions. So these lines shows that first of all, there is a word just please, okay? In spite of using will you have the goodness, sir, just use the word please and don't use grammatical phrases, grammatical sentences like to direct me to. No, just speak out the main words, what you want to say. Charing Cross, which way? He says, George Bernard Shaw says, that if you will do such kind of thing, then half a dozen of people, means many people, will come out and will help you and tell you the directions. Even in private intercourse with cultivated people, you must not speak too well. Now, this was the case when you are talking to a stranger. Now, if you are discussing something in private with the known people, with your known people, then even in those moments as well, even at those moments, you have no need. There is no need to speak in a very fine way or use grammatical phrases, grammatical sentences. Apply this to your attempts to learn foreign languages and never try to speak them too well. And he says that you can apply this formula to other foreign languages you want to or you wish to speak or you wish to learn and never try to speak these foreign languages too well or in a fine manner. And do not be afraid to travel. Most important thing is, If you are able to speak a language in a very fair manner, then that's okay. Then don't afraid to travel. You can move anywhere in the country if you know just a little bit of that language. You will be surprised to find how little you need to know or how badly you may pronounce. He says that you will be, the listeners of this recording will be surprised to know that in order to travel somewhere, you need to know just a little bit of that country's language. And you can pronounce the words of that language in a very bad manner, and that will not matter to anybody. Even among English people, to speak too well is a pedantic affectation in a foreigner. It is something worse than an affectation. It is an insult to the native who cannot understand his own language when it is too well spoken. That is all I can tell you. The recording will hold no more. Goodbye. So in these lines, pedantic affectation means, first of all, pedantic means rules, and affectation means not to obey those rules. So among English people, to speak too well is a pedantic affectation, means that English people think is that speaking too well, speaking English in a very good manner is, what is that? It is not, if you are speaking English in a good manner, you are not following the rules, pedantic rules, and affectation, not following the rules. So English people think if someone is speaking English in a very good manner, that person is not following the rules. And in case of a foreigner, it is something worse than an affectation. And if a foreigner, see, in this line, it is about English people. If an English person is speaking English in a very good manner, then that person is not following the rules. He is rejecting the rules. And if a foreigner does the same thing, and if a foreigner speaks English in a very well manner, then the natives of English people, English speaking countries, sees it as a crime. More than affectation means more than rejecting a rule, means it can be considered as a crime. Means to speak English in a very good manner by a foreigner is taken to be a crime. And then there is a comment by the writer or the recorder that it is very insulting for English people. It is very native, here native means English people, that it is very insulting for the natives of English speaking countries that they cannot understand their own language when it is well spoken. Okay, when someone speaks their own language, means English, in a very good way, they are not able to understand it. And this is very insulting on their part. So with this, he bids goodbye to everybody because the record cannot hold more than this. So this is our text, spoken English and broken English. Okay. Thank you for listening.